acid test of combat, the men and machines that struggled through the Second World War were routinely asked to perform the impossible. And of all the Luftwaffe planes that flew in the conflict, no machine typifies this adaptability and perseverance better than the Junkers Ju-88. Dubbed by its crewmen the maid of all work, its airframe could be pressed into service in many differing roles, proving the validity of the basic design. The 88, originally intended as a high-speed bomber, was eventually given numerous missions, even as a fighter plane. Without question, it was the most versatile Luftwaffe aircraft of the Second World War. The stalwart machine's prototype first took to the air on the 21st of December 1936. It underwent many modifications and fought doggedly to the war's end. Unlike some of the Luftwaffe's more stunning jet and rocket aircraft, the secret of the 88's success lay in the versatility of its airframe. Throughout the conflict, the plane was altered repeatedly, yet still maintained its structural integrity. Not surprisingly, 88s that fell into Allied hands were scrutinized very carefully. American assessment crews that examined this model, A688, were amazed by the sheer versatility of the machine. A versatility that U.S. Army Air Force designers were never able to match. Allied intelligence groups were keen to gain as much information as possible about the Luftwaffe's sturdiest workhorse. Pilot evaluation concentrated on the aircraft's facility in handling airframe stresses, particularly in its diving characteristics. General Carl Spatz directed all American air operations in Europe and commanded the U.S. 8th Air Force. He was intensely interested in information gathered about German aircraft. Ironically, the Ju-88's stressed metal construction was actually designed by American specialists working for the Junkers company in pre-war years. Spatz was interested in all areas of German aviation technology that so often seemed years ahead of Allied capability. With grudging respect, Spatz would often personally take part in the disassembly of captured German hardware. After some preliminary precautions, the American crew entered the 88 through the bottom hatch, which was also part of the lower gun turret. This bathtub arrangement was also used in early B-17 flying fortresses, but not persevered with. The 88 used a variety of engines, and the mounting points were so versatile that the same plane could mount two types of engines. Yumo engines were fitted to most of the later models. Their circular shape may suggest that they're radials, but they're actually inline engines with rounded forward radiators. Another strength of the 88's design was the single-strut oleo landing gear, which acted like a large shock absorber, reducing the impact of landing and enabling the plane to work from crude airfields common to front-line operations. Given that the 88 flew on all German fronts, often under appalling combat conditions, these two simple features were vital to its success. When the 88 was first developed, it was seen simply as a Schnell bomber, a plane that could fly more swiftly than the enemy fighters trying to gun it down. This was a concept that German military theorists had often espoused between the wars. With the ascent of the Third Reich and Hitler officially Chancellor, Germany's military theorists were finally able to transform their ideas into the tools of aggression that the Führer so desperately sought. Long before the 88 became a reality, the Schnell bomber concept had been a dream of earlier Luftwaffe planners. It first showed itself in another Junkers aircraft, the Ju-86. Foretelling what the 88 would become, the 86 was a twin-engine bomber which relied on speed and defensive firepower. It boasted a lower dustbin gun emplacement and a second gun at the top of the fuselage. The weaponry was far from devastating, but in an era when most of the interceptors were slower biplanes, the 86's swiftness alone presented good defense. The 86 came with a variety of power plants, underscoring Junkers' early commitment to building versatile aircraft. This philosophy wasn't limited to the machine's hardware, because the plane was built to perform a myriad of roles. Apart from being one of the most advanced bombers of the day, the 86 was transformed into an airliner, eagerly received by commercial carriers in several countries. When Hitler sent some 6,000 Luftwaffe personnel to aid Franco in the Spanish Civil War, the 86 went along. Later, the aircraft was modified to fly at ultra-high altitudes. Known as the P model, it had a pressurized crew compartment, which together with its powerful 950 horsepower engines, enabled the two-man crew to fly reconnaissance missions at what was for the time an incredible height of 40,000 feet. The P model carried out reconnaissance missions over Britain, Russia, and North Africa with total impunity. High and fast, during the first half of the Second World War, even the best Allied fighters hadn't a chance of catching it. By the time the war erupted in Europe, the 86 was outmoded as a conventional bomber. As early as 1939, this kind of combat role was assigned to aircraft like the rugged Heinkel 111. The 111 itself was a product of an evolution all its own dating back to 1934. It too saw service over Spain. And when Germany's forces smashed into Poland, the 111 played a pivotal role. But the Heinkel was a horizontal bomber, and although faster than the 86, it was still underarmed and needed escort fighters to protect it when delivering its lethal cargo. The 111's partner for the first part of the war was an even more versatile aircraft, the Dornier DO-17. Another design from 1934, the Dornier had links to commercial aviation. The DO-17 was an extremely sturdy design, and with its heavily loaded wing, had the ability to adopt several different types of engine. Its slim fuselage prompted the nickname the Flying Pencil. The nose section carried the entire crew, a layout that was later adopted by the Ju-88. Luftwaffe planners recognized the advantages inherent in the Dornier, and its success certainly influenced the later Junkers design. As a conventional bomber, the DO-17 proved coldly efficient. Flying unerringly high above its targets, the 17 dispatched its bombs with deadly accuracy. But because of the stress loadings built into the 17's extraordinarily strong airframe, the plane was well suited to another kind of bombing that Luftwaffe pilots had already used to cow the armies of Europe. Dive bombing. To better adapt the Dornier, certain models were fitted with a unique dive brake located behind the aircraft. This slowed the aircraft's rate of descent as it plunged headlong towards its target. The Dornier DO-17 taught Luftwaffe commanders a valuable lesson: that aircraft designed with one job in mind could, with a little effort, quite often be geared for a totally different role. and be terribly effective at it. The Luftwaffe's Ju-88 was probably the classic embodiment of this philosophy. It was a foresight that became myopic in a way because it overlooked the traditional four-engine bomber, the plane that the British and the Americans eventually used to level the Reich. The exception to this oversight was the four-engined Heinkel 177 Greif, or Griffin. It looked like a two-engined aircraft, but in fact each propeller was driven by two power plants, coupled together and occupying each nacelle. A highly advanced design. But the complicated engine coupling mechanism often failed, and sometimes resulted in fire. With the demise of the 177, the Luftwaffe was left without a serious match for the Allies' four-engine bombers. Without such a long-range threat, German air power, relying on shorter-range twin-engine bombers, never truly possessed the offensive capability which enabled Allied air forces to wreak such devastation over the Fatherland. The Griffin's failure was due entirely to the sophisticated engine arrangement. But in every other way, the highly advanced, streamlined design was a credit to its builders when it first flew in 1939. When the war began, it soon became clear that Allied technology lagged desperately behind. Facing the mighty Luftwaffe, Britain's dubious arsenal included machines like the Handley Page Hampden, a twin radial engine aircraft conceived in the mid-30s. This plane actually performed the RAF's first bombing raid against Germany. The Hampden, together with the Handley Page Hereford, was the backbone of British Bomber Command in the war's opening stages. Another contemporary of the Hampden was the Armstrong Whitworth Whitley. Both designs show how ill-equipped the RAF was to undertake long-range bombing in 1939. Britain's one shining star was the Vickers Wellington, which had a unique geodetic construction that gave the fuselage enormous strength. This basket-weave bomber soon gained a reputation for being able to endure incredible punishment and still return its crew safely home. Smaller than the Wellington was the Bristol Blenheim, another design dating back to the mid-30s. It was very fast for the time, but could only carry a modest bomb load. As the war drew on, Hampdens, Blenheims, and Wellingtons were soon joined by American aircraft like this Martin Baltimore. With limitations similar to its British counterparts, this medium bomber was of little help in the RAF's quest to match Hitler's Luftwaffe and carry the air war into the German heartland. However, it wasn't long before the Americans contributed two medium bombers that matched and even exceeded the Luftwaffe's capabilities. The first was the North American B-25. Here, at long last, the Allies had a bomber that approached the versatility already enjoyed by German bomber pilots. Called the Mitchell, the B-25 saw action in the Pacific, North Africa, and Europe as a conventional bomber, and also as an attack aircraft armed with a lethal array of machine guns or cannon mounted in the nose. Another successful American medium bomber was the B-26 Marauder. Less versatile than the B-25, the Marauder was a very fast aircraft, but at times difficult to handle. Heavily armed to defend against attacking fighters, the Marauder was sturdy and reliable, once its crew came to terms with the demands of this high-performance aircraft. Overall, Allied medium bombers were probably not as versatile as their German counterparts, but they nearly always packed more defensive firepower than similar Luftwaffe aircraft. even though this cost the aircraft precious speed due to the extra weight of heavier firepower. By contrast, the German planes inherited the legacy of the Schnell bomber. Speed. A swift machine didn't need a vast array of armament. Yet as the war dragged on and Allied fighters became even faster, Luftwaffe flyers began to pay the price. By the end of 1939, the early versions of the Ju-88 were flowing steadily to the front. Early footage shows an 88's crew preparing their guns before setting out on a bombing mission. The machine guns are 7.92mm MG-15s, made by Rheinmetall Borsig, a company that produced much of the Reich's weaponry during the war. Often simple in design and manufacture, but extremely well made, they were symbols of the German tradition of excellence in engineering. The guns were light, easy to handle, and installed with very little effort. Each piece was mounted on a swivel joint, fixed to the fuselage. It was an extremely manageable arrangement, and with the MG-15's reliability in action, it proved itself savagely efficient against Allied fighters. A leather pouch caught the spent cartridges so they could be used again, and so that they didn't clutter the cockpit floor, where they could jam other vital parts. With everything installed, the weapon was secured in a fixed position, so that it didn't interfere with the normal activity in the cockpit. The manufacturers also went to great lengths with this armament configuration to enable either the pilot to control the forward machine gun in a fixed position or a gunner to operate it manually. It was an attempt to combine versatility with effectiveness, with mixed results. Some aircraft even came equipped with an MG-15 in a kit with a conventional butt stop and tripod, so that the weapon could actually be taken out and used as a light machine gun, either on or away from the aircraft. On many occasions, downed crews found this an invaluable asset. The arrangement offered considerable firepower for any airman unfortunate enough to be caught behind enemy lines. Protecting the bomber's vulnerable underside was left to a gunner lying prone in the turret, looking below and behind the aircraft. But even he was within earshot of the other crew members, and having three or four men fighting back to back was thought to provide an important psychological benefit that many Allied bomber crews never knew. Isolated and alone in their stations around the fuselage, an exchange of fire at 20,000 feet was often a terribly lonely experience for British and American gunners. The downside to the close position theory was that in an emergency, the men literally trampled over each other attempting a hasty escape. For some, fighting together would also mean dying together. The MG-15 snapped off a blistering 1,000 rounds a minute and was fed by a dual drum arrangement, where a cartridge was inserted alternately from one side of the ammunition drum to the other. But because the drums only contained 75 rounds each, a large number of magazines were kept on hand, and in action had to be replaced with a maddening frequency. Still, it was not enough. For even with these added guns, the combined firepower of an entire aircraft was less than that of just one turret on many Allied bombers. Like all other German bombers, more attention had been paid to its prowess as an offensive weapon than its ability to defend itself. Even so, the Junkers 88 was a machine that time after time successfully carried men and their deadly cargo into harm's way and back again. Werner Seitz, a Ju-88 pilot, explains.
I believe the Ju-88 for this time, it was one of the finest bombers we had. But it's a bomber, yeah? It's not a fighter. Well, the armament, and that was more or less to give you some moral support when you were firing the guns, or you had a good feeling, yeah? That's like you're losing some pressure that builds up in the sights when you hear those machine guns firing. You feel you have some kind of protection. But I didn't do much harm to attacking aircraft. We were very lucky to get away from a fighter. We, for instance, we used to have a cannon in the front. The cannon was in our way, so we decided to take those out to have more room for the navigator when we flew the actual attack, because he had to go down on his knees to go to the site. Yeah? When that cannon on the ammunition was just a nuisance to have, and what could you do in the night? You were attacked and you tried to shake that aircraft up with all kind of different flying characters, with curving, going down, changing altitude, and so it was kind of a moral support for you when you heard those guns going off. And were your own guns, you did not hear the gun from the attacking aircraft, or what you know, you saw those bullets, tracers flying by, and you hope for the best, you will get out of the mess. Yeah. So we took the guns out. We know better than the designer what is good for ourselves, because we were flying it. And so we did improvement ourselves. We didn't ask for permission, we just went ahead and did it. The other things what we did, the brakes for diving, slow down the aircraft a little bit, not much, but in case when you try to be a little faster, every little bit helps. So we took even those out.
Air crews were very intimate with their aircraft and often made personalized changes to them to suit better the combat conditions they found themselves in. From the very outset of the war, thin convoys stretching across the Atlantic were Britain's umbilical cord. They were easy prey to prowling German U-boat wolf packs. Long-range escorts, like the Sunderland flying boat, meant to counter the threat, were slow and only served as juicy targets for Ju-88s on maritime patrol. Far from shore, when the lumbering Sunderlands came under attack, they were forced to fend for themselves until, if their luck held, fighters could reach the scene. The Sunderland's predicament illustrates the era's ongoing debate as to whether large bombers, given enough firepower, could adequately defend themselves. Here, 388s, although more agile and faster than the Sunderland, are held at bay by the flying boat's blazing powered turrets and manual gun positions. The defensive firepower of the Sunderland was formidable and gave rise to a well-deserved nickname, the Porcupine. But even so, the best it could hope to do against attacking 88s was to hold them at bay until help arrived. By the same token, this incident depicts just how versatile Germany's Ju-88 really was, on this occasion as a bomber performing the role of long-range attack fighter. But before long, when faced by Britain's Bristol Bowfighter, an aircraft specifically designed for this task, it was the 88 that found itself on the defensive. In the end, the versatility of aerial weapons like the Ju-88, although at times truly ingenious, was debilitating. Debilitating because sooner or later these aircraft faced enemy machines specifically designed for tasks for which they were merely jury-rigged. It was never an even match. The A-Series 88, the basic bomber version, had a glasshouse nose, giving the crew superb visibility and the bombardier excellent vision for sighting his target. With 88s like these, Goering's mighty Luftwaffe tried to bring England to her knees. During the Battle of Britain, 88 bomber crews probably had a better chance of survival than those in HE-111s and DO-17s, because the Junkers plane was faster and had added diving ability. But like all German medium bombers, it was underarmed, and without a fighter escort, losses were heavy. Britain's battle to survive the Luftwaffe onslaught will be remembered as the first major German setback. But it also gave Goering vital lessons about previously untried tactics, albeit at a high price. Despite this, the 88s kept coming. In the summer of 1940, along with the Luftwaffe's other aircraft, they nearly obliterated the airfields of southern England and knocked the RAF out of action. Only with Hitler and Goering's sudden insistence that tactics change, with intensive bombing raids launched against British cities instead, did the RAF gain a slight respite from the Luftwaffe campaign. Over Britain, the 88 vindicated its designers. But much of its success lay with the men who flew it into battle. Many of these crews saw the 88 as a death trap. Werner Seitz recalls.
I had a choice. I wanted to become a fighter pilot. But for some reason, till today, I don't know why I was sent to become a horizontal and dive bomber. That means flying Stukas like the U-87, U-88, and later on I had even a chance to fly the U-188. So I went through the training, but I will not forget to mention one thing. When I talked to he mentioned, I feel sorry for you that you will be flying the U-88. And I asked him, why do you think is it such a bad plane? He said, well, we call it just a flying coffin, yeah? Well, everybody has his own idea. I learned later on it was a wonderful flying aircraft, and I really enjoyed flying those two-engine Junkers 88s.
The glazed nose wasn't present in every 88. Developed at the same time were various heavy fighter models, including a radar-equipped night fighter. Employed for prowling the darkened skies over Germany, technology like the Liechtenstein radar was considered so important that when a stray 88 night fighter accidentally landed in Switzerland and was impounded, Hitler ordered its crew to be shot on their return. Far from the skies above the English Channel, the 88 also flew into battle over the Mediterranean. Here, British convoys supplying the beleaguered 8th Army in North Africa were constantly harassed by attacking 88s. Control of this body of water was vital, and the fact that the Luftwaffe was never able to become dominant eventually led to the Afrika Korps' final defeat. The cornerstone of British success in the Mediterranean was the island of Malta. This small dot of land held on against punishing Luftwaffe raids carried out daily throughout the spring of 1942. When the stalwart defenders refused to accept defeat, the Luftwaffe turned its attention to British convoys. As in the attacks on the island itself, the 88 proved devastating. The German plane accounted for the loss of thousands of tons of Allied shipping in the attempt to starve Malta into submission. Somehow, the tiny outpost survived. A fact that was very much due to the island's civilian population. People who endured dreadful conditions from the bombing and the shortages that followed, rather than leave their homes. Throughout the war, 88s were adapted and readapted for a myriad of tasks. Some were extensions of the basic model, others were complete redesigns, like the 188. Eric Sommers, an 88 crew member, explains.
It's a Tiger 88. It was altered all the time. It was developed as a reconnaissance aircraft, as a ground fighter, a night fighter. And when the aircraft is capable to carry about a bomb load of 2.5 tons, then you can put a lot of equipment in, which makes it versatile. And it had the speed, it had the production numbers for replacement. And so that was the reason this aircraft was developed further.
The 188 had an improved cockpit, and some versions were even pressurized for the type of high-altitude reconnaissance work earlier performed by the Ju-86. Reconnaissance crews played a major role in Wehrmacht campaigns, but were never showered with the attention that fighter pilots received. Their aircraft were often unarmed, and at lower levels they were vulnerable to enemy fighters. At higher levels, the enemy was the intensely cold air, at altitudes sometimes exceeding 40,000 feet. Some basic 88 models were converted, like this T series. As the war progressed, additional derivatives, including the 188 and the 288, were on the drawing board. Intelligence in the form of airborne photography played a critical role on both sides. In Goering's Luftwaffe, it was undertaken by no less than 3 generations of Junkers bombers, dating back to the early Ju-86. The emphasis placed by German strategists on aerial intelligence is best illustrated by the vast number of aircraft constructed for that purpose. There were over 1,900 reconnaissance 88s built at a time when intense pressure was being exerted to manufacture nothing but fighters and bombers. Luftwaffe reconnaissance work not only included gathering intelligence on enemy positions and movements, but also evaluating the effectiveness and aftermath of German attacks on those positions. Success or failure would determine future methods. One area where the front line was extremely fluid was in the desert tracts of North Africa. Here, the British confronted Rommel's North Africa Corps, in a test of strength and guile that was entirely unpredictable. Although the warfare was primarily confined to armored vehicles on the ground, aerial missions played a major role, and here again the 88 was a pivotal actor. By performing reconnaissance duties and bombing missions, the plane was tested in one of the war's most demanding theaters. With very little protection and poor visibility, the underpart of the fuselage was the 88's Achilles heel. Lightly armed to begin with, the undersurfaces were virtually naked to enemy fire. The weakness was mainly due to grouping the crew in the forward cockpit. In Allied aircraft like the B-25 and the B-26, the defensive positions were spread all along the length of the fuselage and included a tail gunner position for protection from the rear.
In Ku-88, everybody was in the front compartment. As a navigator, I was sitting on the right-hand side. Having worked out my navigation, had only a small area to work on. I didn't have a table. So everything was set out beforehand. Had my maps lined up on the right-hand side, had my machine gun on the front, and to get to the machine gun, I had to lay with my belly on a retractable floor. Under the floor was a bomb limb. So when I didn't want to make a bomb run, I pushed the floor forward and I could lay there and be behind my machine gun. Or I could sleep there. We did that too. There was good communication first with direct communication, because in the Ku-88 you could practically talk with everybody, above the noise, of course, yelling, but with your intercom, you were always in touch. The Russians, of course, brought a lot of egg up there, but we ignored it, yeah. You just ignore it. It was the only way to do it. Just went your own way. It was a cloud of egg. We went through, just did our bombing run and forgot it. Yeah. And night fighters were not, at the time, a big danger. Not a big danger. Of course, we watched out for it. Mm-hmm. At night, you don't see anything except when the fire comes up.
Droning through the dark night over hostile territory, each Luftwaffe crewman was left to his own thoughts and fears during the long journey to and from targets behind the Russian lines. Here, the intimacy of a crew working within reach of one another paid the psychological dividends originally intended by the plane's designers. Although Luftwaffe night missions had mixed results, daytime raids at the outset of the invasion of the Soviet Union met spectacular success. Here too, the 88 was a vital tool. Russian airfields were numerous and widespread, leaving only three bombers to each target. Still, the 88 got the job done. Eventually, though, Russia would have its revenge. With each passing winter, surviving Luftwaffe ground crews toiled in unbearably primitive and harsh conditions. The 88 had been built with maintenance very much in mind, but nothing could have prepared it for the cruel environment of the Eastern Front. By the end of 1944, the Third Reich was crumbling in a firestorm of its own making. Retreating on all fronts, soon even Luftwaffe airfields and the fatherland itself reflected the devastation. By the time the Junkers 88 was forced out of production, nearly 15,000 had gone into action. Over half of those were bombers, and about 4,000 flew as fighters defending the Reich. No less than 7 major German aircraft manufacturers took part in the effort to build the plane. Despite these vast numbers, few 88s fell into Allied hands. One or two did find their way to America, where they were closely examined. The cockpit arrangement, firepower sacrificed for crew proximity, was a source of debate amongst US Air Force designers. They examined the practicality of huddling the crew together while asking them to tackle several different assignments. American pilots compared the 88's performance with that of their own medium bombers at the time, with the general consensus that the 88 was an extremely strong plane and not as difficult to fly as expected. In many ways, it resembled the performance of multi-engine British fighters of the period. This 88 is unique. Manufactured in June of 1943, it was among many Luftwaffe frontline aircraft transferred to Germany's ally, Romania. But in less than a month, its Romanian pilot defected, bringing with him a prized catch, his mint condition Ju-88. He landed the aircraft in British-controlled Cyprus, and the RAF quickly had it spirited to Cairo, and then on to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in the United States. It was rare indeed for such a pristine example of any German aircraft to find its way to the US. During the war, Allied flyers had learned much about the 88. A glazed nose was the telltale sign of the bomber model, and an invitation to enemy fighters attacking it. Because only the fighter 88 with its heavy caliber guns mounted in a solid nose intimidated them. Towards the war's end, German pilots caught on to this and painted the solid nose to resemble its glazed, less venomous cousin. The resulting misidentification is said to have cost many Allied lives. Just one example of how a simple field modification involving a pot of paint and a little illusion had as deadly an effect as a complicated technological innovation. A hastily gathered force of about 188 fighter intruders took off on March the 3rd, 1945, in a final gesture of defiance against the Allied onslaught. Flying into heavily defended British airspace, they caught the RAF totally by surprise. In the pitch-black skies over England, over 20 unsuspecting Allied bombers were shot down. Facing defeat as they were, Luftwaffe flyers knew full well that they were the last line of defense left to Germany's civilian population. A population suffering carnage nightly in Allied bombing raids. The next evening, the Luftwaffe tried to repeat their victory, but this time were hotly received by British night fighters and AK-AK. The 20 planes shot down this time were German. At approximately 1:45 in the morning, the last Ju-88 crashed into a Yorkshire field, giving it the dubious honor of being the final enemy plane shot down over Britain. In its career, the redoubtable 88 was used to test almost every form of aerial weapon. It was heavily employed in jet engine research, and the power plants that ultimately went on to propel the Luftwaffe's famous jets were first installed and tested underneath the Ju-88. Similarly, Germany's rocket assistance takeoff units first proved their worth during tests on Junkers bombers. Almost without exception, when a bomber was needed to test a German innovation, the 88 would be called upon to serve as a guinea pig. One of the most bizarre uses found for the 88 was in the Mistral missions, where the planes were sacrificed as aerial bombs. To achieve this, the whole nose section was removed and up to 4 tons of high explosive put in its place. Then a Luftwaffe fighter, usually an FW-190, was mounted on top of the bomber, and the two aircraft were flown as one by the pilot and the fighter. On approaching the target, the fighter pilot released the unmanned bomber, which then plunged down to its mark. It was truly an act of desperation for Germany's hopeless cause. And despite the great courage displayed by the pilots flying these missions, one that never really succeeded. Although the odd success did bring devastating results. The Romanian 88, passed on to the American Air Force courtesy of its defecting pilot, is one of only 4 aircraft that remain of nearly 15,000 built. Displayed at the Wright-Patterson Air Force Museum in Dayton, Ohio, it has stood silent vigil now for nearly half a century. an impressive monument to one of the Luftwaffe's greatest design achievements. It embodies a German aviation philosophy founded upon a trinity all its own: simplicity, ruggedness, and versatility. These three things and much more, the swift Junkers plane had without question. One of the great high-speed bombers of the Second World War. A high point of German design and engineering.